How come ET is being featured so much at the London Olympics with all the crazy weird advertisements with saucers flying through the air and all sorts of bizarre symbology about ET? I don't know. It makes you wonder though, doesn't it? Good morning. Sunday morning, 22nd of July, and the Olympics are going to kick off. And I said July is the month when the whole ball gets rolling, both positive and negative. And it certainly will, certainly already has. This Colorado tragedy is very much part of that whole process of demolition, as it were. You know, we don't realize the leverage, how it's used in putting on this movie of loss. Existence is simply a movie of loss. And here's a way to look at it. Let's say you go into the movie theater, which I don't suggest anyone does. I sure don't, haven't for a long time. But let's say you're in a movie theater and before the movie starts, there's the screen is open. Let's say there's a webcam on the outside that's showing you beautiful trees and the sky and nice lake, and you know, and you're seeing, oh, okay, outside is wonderful. So you're sitting there in the theater waiting for the movie to start. And then as you're watching the screen, you start seeing some clouds coming in, some dark clouds. You go, oh my gosh, it looks like a storm is coming in outside. And then lightning starts striking, and you say, holy smokes, you know, this, my gosh, it was a beautiful day when I came in here, and I'm seeing on the screen that, and the weather's changing. Oh, there's a strong wind out there, you know, and you hear the whoo of the wind coming through the speakers. There's microphones outside, you can hear the outside, and then suddenly you see these crafts coming streaking across the sky, and boom, they're bombing, and before you know it, there's this huge invasion going on, and you say, oh, holy smokes, the world is being attacked, it's being destroyed, this is horrible. And you look around, you say, oh, you know, I'm safe in this theater, at least I'm safe here, nothing's happened here, I better stay right here, because, you know, it seems to be a safe place to be. And so but meanwhile, you're just like freaking out, and then you sit there, and people are sitting in their seats just complete in shock, devastated. They say, oh my God, everybody out there's been killed, the whole world's been destroyed. Oh, and just, you know, complete numbness, feeling of nothingness, just numbness. We get deflated, you know, everyone's just like, I'm so destroyed, I feel terrible, you know, the whole world's gone to pieces, I can't function, I can't move, I can't do anything, this is so, I'm completely depressed and despondent and gone insane and hysterical and just terrible like that. So, now, let me explain something. As you're watching the screen, when you come in the movie theater, you're watching the screen, and you think you're seeing a picture of the outside. You are, initially, and the microphones are picking up the sound. What they're doing is they're able to begin to substitute a movie for the live feed, okay, outside. And they capture the live feed and somehow loop it through, and then digitally, almost like in real time, a slight delay, okay, but they have the capability to digitally alter the feed coming in from outside so that they put their own digital effects on it, okay? And so what you're actually seeing is simply digital effects, okay? And you're watching a movie, but you think you're still watching the live feed outside, but you're not. So in other words, everything you're seeing on the screen has now turned into simply a movie that there is being screened for you. But you don't realize that this has happened. So outside is actually perfect. There's nothing wrong outside. But it's done so flawlessly. There was no point where you saw, wait a minute, this is no longer the outside feed, it's now a movie. Because you're seeing the landscape outside, you're still seeing it. But see, this has all been modeled, digitally modeled, so they can then put on all these effects of the storm coming in, the lightning, the attacks, alien invasion, and all these kinds of things. Destruction of the planet, and why to give you this experience of loss, which is the whole purpose of existence. It's based on loss, experiencing loss. Okay. And we've gone over that many times, and we will many times more. The important thing is that what we're seeing in existence is like being in that movie theater and watching this movie. It started out and we think, oh, okay, it's reality, it's very beautiful. And then suddenly these distortions came in, storms started coming, stuff started happening, loss started happening. And we thought that reality was suffering these losses. It's not. It's simply a movie. So everything we're seeing here, everything we're seeing in existence is just like a movie. It's not reality at all. Not reality at all. And you can stretch this analogy even further, but we won't bother with that now. But if you are able to, you can do that. There's no loss taking place in reality whatsoever. None. Zero. Loss is impossible in reality. But here we are, you know, freaking out, thinking we've lost reality, has been destroyed, this is horrible, and we're experiencing this feeling like our spirit has been crushed. We've got no home, we're now homeless, we have no hope, etc. Of course, then into this movie we're watching comes some kind of savior or something, right? Someone shows up and says, all is not lost. Like E.T. shows up and says, people of the earth, all is not lost. Do not lose hope. We know the way to help you. We are here to help you. And then we all say, oh, gosh, please help us out. What do we do? just like that. You can stretch all of this, play with it, inquire into it, etc. But really, all of existence is this movie that we're watching, thinking that all this loss we're seeing is happening to reality. Yeah. And of course, there's great loss to come in this movie. All right, it's not existence. This whole purpose is to use loss to establish a new reality. By believing, we believe if we feel we lose everything, that somehow this will cause a transformation, a magical rebirth, like a phoenix rising from the ashes. And we believe that we will be reborn as a new being, new reality, where we set the rules, where we're prime creators. Prime creator means we set the rules. And so we're imposing loss, constantly imposing loss, trying to crush our spirits. Now, spirit can not be crushed, but it can experience experience of total chaos, symbolically, so to speak, that nothing can be lost, really. Okay, when you track loss down all the way, you find out that what you really experience is just total chaos. Everything is still there, but it's completely randomly moving around and being hit and bouncing around. It's just all completely chaotic, which is a horrible, horrible experience. So the Olympics are coming up. And this should be very momentous. It's going to be a very momentous times in the world. Very momentous as far as loss goes. We don't understand the levels of loss so well. We got an intuitive feel of it. That just because there's a tragedy there in Colorado and 12 people lost their lives, etc. You say, well, okay, 12 people lost their lives. Now, what happened was, there's a loss of trust, a loss of will, a loss of freedom, a loss in a lot of different ways have been brought about by that. It's accelerating this loss, just like 9/11. How much have we lost since 9/11? It's almost incalculable. Since I came into this world in 1956, and how much have I experienced as far as lifestyle, freedom, feeling of safety, etc. Incalculable. The loss has been colossal. But since 9/11, I can tell for sure, being aware of the freedom beforehand and now, it is like we've almost lost everything. I feel like I can't travel. I can't say what I want to say. There's just a massive, massive gutting of the feeling of being able to present yourself in the world and to spontaneously be here and move and connect and all that. It's become like paralyzed. So all these tragedies and these horrible events stifle the spirit of freedom more and more and more and more and more. Horribly so. So we have gone through a most drastic loss already in this world. It's insufferable, really. And, you know, when we try to speak up, there's so many things that if you even mention them, you're going to be cowering in fear, you know, just because, you know, it's like we live in Germany in 1939 or something. Really. You don't dare open up various avenues and express yourself. I mean, who's expressing themselves, really? Just the way people walk, my gosh. You can tell how people feel by the way they walk. I went into downtown San Jose recently, and I was just watching the people walk. Everybody was walking very strangely. It's like, wow. I just was noticing, look, what is that? What is that walk, the gait? You know, it's just like, everyone's like crippled in some way, so to speak. They don't have that free and easy gait. People remarked about my teacher, Ananda Maima, how she walked, and they said they could tell she was this being of complete clarity by the way she walked. It's an extraordinary walk. People don't walk like that. And just comparing the way that people walk now is the way they used to walk. It's so different. My gosh, I can hardly walk right now. As a matter of fact, very difficult. Some days it's hard to walk. And that's because of all this loss, this terrible gutting that we've experienced of self-assurance, this assurance, this love, this feeling, this buoyancy, this lightness, this feeling that we can truly be translated and ascend, and we're not bound by this world and all this stuff that you don't see that kind of walk anymore. Everybody is almost robotic sort of thing. Either kind of crippled or robotic, or, you know. No, just go out. Just look at how people walk and go to different places. Like in downtown San Jose, people were shuffling. They weren't really walking, they were shuffling. It always scares me when I go there and look at the way that people walk. I said, holy cow, what is going on here? And you see the people who have still some entitlement here, they strut along, you know, they strut along. Where do you see that? This free and easy gait, you know, it's just cruising like they're floating. You know, where do you see that now? We used to see that. My gosh, in the 60s, you know, it's like, wow, everybody was strutting. And everybody was moving. They were walking. Man, they were flowing, you know, and just since the way things have gone now, everybody is compressed. They're all compressed, and they're kind of shuffling along. You know, there's not this free and easy, just sparkle. You know, no way, no way. And the people just assume this is the way it's always been, and we kind of forget how it used to be. So we have suffered. We've already gone through the peak. Now, in existence, the way it works is that existence is based on producing experience of loss. It's loss-based movie, so to speak. Why? Because loss is the way we forget reality. And why do we want to forget reality? You know the answer. Because we want to be prime creator. If we were aware of reality, we'd know we're not prime creator. We'd know what we are, what we truly are, which is the prime created. We complete the creation. We're not the cause, we're the effect that completes the cause. And we're everything, and we have perfect access to direct experiencing of all essence in infinite directions and modalities simultaneously, whatever we want. It's just, it's riches beyond belief. We cannot even imagine it. We forgot, we wanted to forget that so that we could believe that we're cause. Effects are cause. We wanted to be prime creator. We wanted to be the one that established the rules and the laws of reality. So how do we do that? We have to forget. We have to have amnesia about reality, about what we are. How do we do that? Loss. Loss, 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 loss. Because there's no loss in reality. Zero. No such thing as loss. No such thing as harm, corruption, decay, breaking, diminishment. Nothing's impossible. Reality never shrinks. It's ever expanding, endlessly expanding. There's no shrinkage. There's no loss there. No loss at all. So by presenting this vast scenario of loss, we certainly or have this amnesia. We don't remember reality at all. Which then enables us to do the second part. What we want is to imagine that we are becoming prime creator. There's a way to become prime creator. And then we just imagine, well, all this loss is pleasing to some deity that's more powerful than reality, more powerful than God. And this deity just wants to be assured that we really, really, really want to be prime creator. And we're really willing to lose all of reality forever. And that if we can convince this deity that that's what we really want, then this deity will release the power to us that we can be prime creator. Okay. We just made all these things up. We don't even realize it. And we also hope that we can create, out of all of this loss, we're going to develop more and more and more capabilities, so eventually we'll be prime creator. We just have this magical belief in magic, that so loss has initially its purpose is to give us amnesia about reality. And then we add on to that hey, this loss is going to get us what we want. We got no choice but to believe that, because we're stuck with loss. I mean, loss is how we have amnesia about reality. But we still want to be prime creator. So we say, okay, what can we do with this loss? How can this loss work for our benefit? And we say, oh yeah, this loss is going to prove to some magical deity that we're really, truly loyal to this magical deity. And this magical deity will then bestow the power to be prime creator upon us. Just make it up. I mean, what else do we have to do in loss except to make stuff up, to imagine that this is all to our benefit? It's all going to enable us to reach our goal. We have to, you know, believe that one way or another. Either it's a magical deity, or we make a deity out of progress, or we make a deity out of luck, meaning we make the belief that there's some magical power that we're going to get some way or somehow through this whole loss-based scenario. And it's all simply make-believe. There is no such power. None. Been wasting our time. So we're trying to make the most of loss. Everybody is trying to do their part. Coming to this world, you know, you're doing your part, adding to the loss. Unless you're a true savior of the world. What do you need to do about loss? Do you need to stop the loss? How can you stop the loss? Other than by dropping this whole desire to be prime creator. How can you have the desire to be prime creator and not have this lost-based scenario? How's that possible? The answer is it's not possible. Because you have to have severe amnesia about reality in order to even entertain the notion that you could be prime creator. Even to entertain the possibility. Because if you were aware, if you knew reality, if you're aware of it, you know what you are, and you know you're not prime creator, and you know that the laws of reality cannot be violated, they cannot be changed. It's impossible. You know it. So you, as soon as you have the idea of wanting to be prime creator, you have to, boom, suddenly you think you're still seeing reality, but you're really seeing a movie, and in this movie, loss begins to be generated. First, you see all this sort of constructivity take place, and you think, wow, what's going on? It's very interesting. But of course, you don't realize that in order for loss to take place, there has to be constructivity first. So we don't realize that we've been watching a movie the whole time. We thought that we were watching change in reality at first, and we thought that this is a very neat change. Look at all these planets. Look at all these solar systems. Look at all these galaxies. Look at all this whole universe. And we think, wow, reality is doing something really amazing and weird here. What's going on? It's everything is changed and different, but it's very interesting. And then once all these constructs, you know, get going, then the destructs start get going too. Okay. It's like we watch a tree grow, you know, watch a forest grow. Say, wow, look at that forest grow. It's so beautiful. It's amazing. Oh, it's weird. What's going on here? And then in come the loggers, cut the forest down. Say, I lost the whole forest. It's gone. I lost it all, you know. You can't have loss without first constructs. Constructivity. So we thought that we were watching reality when all these constructs, we were not. We were watching a movie. We were watching our imagination. But our imagination first presented the constructivity predominantly, and then destructivity comes in, and that cycle continues. So what we've done is we have built up so much constructivity in this world and reached a peak. I think maybe it reached a peak like in the late 60s, mid early 70s, something like that. And then it's been downhill. So we reached this peak of freedom, this peak of feeling constructive. And like, yes, you know, yes, we're almost there. This is great. And then when we reach that peak, it starts declining. It's like a wave crests, builds up, crests. And you think, oh, look at that wave. And then, poof, starts breaking. And as it breaks, it just turns into foam. The wave, where's the wave? It's gone. It's foam. And then with foam, poof, all the bubbles disappear. Waves disappeared. You get this glorious, beautiful wave there in this silken ocean. And you say, oh, I just want to watch this wave. It's so beautiful. And then breaks all the turbulence, foam. Okay, gone. So this world has already peaked, and it's now severely on the decline. It's into the destructive phase. So I came in during the time when it was going towards the peak of the constructive phase, and I said, hey, folks, don't lose your heads here. This is all going to peak and then go into the destructive phase. And they said, oh, no, you're crazy. What are you talking about? Look how wonderful everything is getting. We're building everything up. The world's so built up. We're going to build peace even. We're going to build peace and love and oneness and harmony and justice. And it's going to be a paradise here. There's not many people that are still believing that. There's still maybe there's a few diehards that are, you know, sitting in front of their fireplace, nursing those ideals. But for those who have the courage to see what's happening and the wisdom and the clarity, you know, it is, the world is in drastic decline. Yeah, it's so drastic that it's off the charts, off the charts. And people wonder about doom, you know, when's the doom coming? The doom is already here. It's already taking place. We're in it. We're in the midst of it. It hasn't reached the point where there's, you know, bodies in the streets, so to speak, and where all, you know, all the bodies die. But the loss and the death of so many hopes and dreams and ideals and massive, 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 massive cataclysm has already happened. 2012 here, July, it's already happened. And now, you know, it's likely to accelerate. It's likely to get real nasty. It's already been real nasty, but it's going to get more graphic, let's say, more graphic. There's so many, 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 many laws and decrees and proclamations and have been passed, and the world's been put in a straitjacket. And this is the play of loss. Play of loss. And for some of us, we say, hey, enough is enough. This is enough loss. I don't want to hang around for the ending, you know. It's just going to be more loss. Shocking. We try to shock ourselves, really. We try to shock ourselves. That's what we're doing. We're trying to, through this dramatic shock of loss that we continually put ourselves through, cycle after cycle, we're trying to appeal. We're trying to appeal to magic is what we're trying to do. We're either trying to gain some sort of new capability through being shocked by loss, or we're trying to prove our loyalty to some imaginary deity, saying, look how we don't have anything to do with the old reality. Look how much loss we've suffered. How could we have any loyalty to the old reality if we went through this terrible loss? It just proves that we're loyal to the new reality. So come on, give us the power. That's what we're really, that's the meta language of existence. What's really going on beneath the surface? That's what's really taking place. No, nobody will say it because that breaks the magic, right? Makes the magical spell. So I was like the spell breaker, and people didn't like that. They didn't like me breaking the spell. I always, in any situation, I'd break the magic spell. At least that was my, what I did then. People would get so upset. They say, what are you talking about? You know, we're almost there. And here you are breaking our mojo down. And I said, no, there's no mojo in existence. There's no imaginary deity that's going to bestow a new reality upon us. This is all a dream. This is all wishful thinking. And so I'd break the spell, and people don't want the spell broken. They don't want it broken. Today, the idealists, they don't want their spell broken. Are you kidding? They're not going to listen to this. They say, no. Peace and love is coming. It's almost here. The planet is going to become this paradise. We're all going to love one another, et cetera, et cetera. Being unaware that we're entering into what is the word? I mean, we really don't have words yet for it. We've seen some precursors to it. A police state, a nightmare, a gulag, a bureaucratic dictatorship, just beyond the opposite of freedom, the opposite of freedom here. Group hysteria, mass delusion, lemmings, you know, just a world has no brakes. It's lost its bearings completely. As expected, as I predicted long ago, of course I said, that's what's going to happen. It's already happened. And it's important to just say things and hear these things. It's not being said if it's not being heard. So the hearing of it by the viewers is actually completing the saying of it. Okay? So if I just say this and there's no viewers, it's not really being said. Maybe at some level it's being heard subtly, most probably. And it's making it tough. It's making it tougher. But it's, as far as stopping the loss, no, you can't stop the loss. You can't stop existence from doing what it does. Because if it did, if we stopped it, we'd remember what we are. And it would all be over. That's not how, that is not how we recover from this situation. We recover by just setting existence down, setting it aside, pushing it aside, and not doing anything about it. Don't need to do anything about it. Just choose a different idea. Choose the idea of not desiring to be prime creator. And then we have no reason to go into amnesia of what we are. What we have need of is to be aware of what we are, is to remember what we are. To experience that change, that not experience loss, which unconditional love, call what you want. There's some people call it the great emptiness, or the, you know, whatever. It's that which cannot experience loss. Some say nothing, you know, where nothing, how can nothing experience loss, the great nothingness? But it is a presence. There's this presence that cannot experience loss. And it's everywhere. There's no boundaries to it. It's boundless. Because if there are boundaries, it's right. Okay, you step over the boundary and you've lost whatever it is. You depart from whatever it is you had. This is boundless. It's boundless. Some call it the great space, spaciousness. Or something. But it's a presence. It's not however you want to describe it, great emptiness, great spaciousness, pure awareness, pure consciousness, vision of Christ, oneness, unconditional love, on and on and on. It is a radiant presence of extreme gentleness and peacefulness and unmovingness and limpid tranquility beyond anything we can imagine. Some people go to lakes, very calm, limpid lakes, and they meditate there because they want to try and remember something, this feeling of this limpid tranquility of infinite gentleness, unbounded and infinite gentleness that doesn't have the slightest disturbance in it whatsoever, and it simply abides in itself like that. Unchanging, unmoving, but yet radiant with complete assurance, beyond assurance. You just feel completely reassured by that experience, which is what meditation is trying to tap into that, trying to. But you see, you can't tap into it because it's everywhere. It's boundless and you cannot tap into it. Because you can't mix it with anything. This is the trouble. Let's put it this way. We all are experiencing difficulty and trouble to feel this, to have this as our experience. And in one way or another, we are not going about it correctly. And that is why you have all these teachers who say all their stuff, you know, and it goes, you know, and round and round and round, and the awareness, and let the wave and the ocean, and you know the whole talk, and it just kind of trying to say, you know, what's the trouble here? And I'll just any questions, and yeah, you know, can I have an experience of this, or how, what do I do with this, and I'm not sure. And so we all have this trouble, and I've pointed out, you know, tried to point out what the trouble is over and over, and that's basically what you get. What you're getting in teaching is people who have trouble experiencing this unconditional love, and they go to others who seem to not be having trouble experiencing it, and they trying to get insight into it. That's it. But the way to get it, so to speak, it may not be what we think. probably the best teaching is a kind of non-teaching. But who can do that? Who can really do that? I don't know. Because we're trying to get it. Somehow what we're trying to do isn't working. And there's a lot of reasons for it. A lot of reasons for it. And we can dig and see all this reluctance and all this worry and concern. It has something to do with, well, it's many faceted, really. It is many faceted. Our fears are many faceted. It has something to do with we want to apply this unconditional love to the world of loss and do a little healing with it. You know, we want to put the unconditional love in a bottle and dispense it, put it on the market, sell it, help people, you know, drink. We've got the unconditional love. Here's a bottle of unconditional love. And it says right here on the label, you know. So great, yeah. See, I feel that healing. I feel the healing. I feel I'm being healed from loss. Right? I don't feel so much loss now. This I don't feel the body I feel in the world. It's kind of like, hey, I'm protected from loss. I don't feel so much loss. We're trying to work some angle on it instead of 100%. And it doesn't work. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. And we've got to quickly get to what does work. What does work is the realization that nothing works. It's a paradox, and it's easy to speak in absolutes, but it's like the mind cannot connect with. There's a part of us that can't connect with that. Cannot connect with it. Cannot connect with absolutes. Cannot. And we keep thinking we have to educate this part of us that cannot connect with the absolutes. It's not educatable. Which brings us up on this block, this obstacle, because almost 100% of the people that any teacher comes in contact with in this world has a lot of faith in education, a lot of belief in education, has had a lot of education. And they believe the whole thing revolves around you need to educate. Something needs to be educated. We believe in education. I never believed in education. I rejected it. Totally. I mean, by the time I was in seventh grade, I turned the off button and paid no more attention. I said, this is all complete BS. Total. You know, still had to pretend to get good grades. So like the just before the test, I would like cram real fast and try to figure out, you know, how to get the right answer and give the answers and somehow pass. And eventually that didn't work anymore. But then the teachers just wouldn't give me bad grades because they said, well, we know you're very smart and we just don't want to flunk you. So we'll give you a C-. The good people. But the belief in education, it's caused the most damage of anything. It's caused the most severe roadblock. And I knew it. I said, this is going to cause such a devastating problem later on, because I was saying these things in the 60s when I was young, in the 70s, trying to reach people, saying this whole belief in education is going to have a devastating effect later on, 2012. Once you get to the times of loss, severe loss, and it's time to free oneself from the whole scenario of loss, to set it aside and say, I'm going to choose no loss instead. So you either choose loss or no loss, right? That's an abstract. It's all or nothing, right? Now,
There's a part of us that cannot understand that. And it's not really part of us. It's a symbol of us that only understands loss. It only can relate to degrees of loss. It cannot relate to no loss at all. And yet we think we have to educate this part of ourselves. And it's not a part of ourselves. We have to educate this Dumkopf, you know, who cannot get this abstract all or nothing. Cannot get it. And so here we are going to the teachers saying, just help me educate this Dumkopf. I cannot do it. I cannot. No matter what I do, I just can't get through to this blockhead, you know. Help me, teacher. Help me. And the teacher says, Who's asking the question? What is this I? What is he talking about? And so the problem is we believe in education. We believe in the power of education instead of the power of truth, power of clarity. The real power is the power of clarity, not the power of education. Education doesn't clarify, really. It only works in the relative realm of non-absolutes. So the teachers can teach in absolutes. I can get into an absolute state, talk in absolutes. That's a wonderful state, but then I realize, you know, there's something that's not getting this. And then try to step it down, you know, educate the blockhead, the non-absolute, the relative, meaning how do I manage loss better? What we're really trying to do in existence, this knucklehead, is trying to manage loss more to our liking. Because it realizes, we call it the ego or something, it realizes that we don't like loss. And so its only question is, how can I manage this loss better? Tell me, what do you want? What do you really want? Meaning, and we say, we want to choose a different idea, a loss-free idea, a lossless idea. We want to experience unconditional love where there's no loss. And the ego doesn't understand. They said, well, how's that going to help manage this loss for you? Because the ego thinks this loss is our home. And it's trying so hard to make this house a home, you know. It just says, what can I do? How can I redecorate this house so you feel it's more like home? You seem so sad here. You seem so lonely and alienated, like you don't want to be here. What can I do to make it, make you feel comfortable here, because this is your home. You got to get used to it. So just explain to me. And we say, well, I hate loss. And the ego says, okay. What kind of loss do you not like? And you say, I don't like any kind of loss. I say, well, I mean, be more specific. And he said, no, zero. I want zero loss. I want... you can't, it says zero there, except it's backwards. I want zero. Is this thing flipped? Let me see. I don't know. Anyway, I want zero loss. Oh, it is flipped. Okay, interesting. I want zero loss. And the ego says, okay. You mean you want to flip it? Let's go. Okay, zero loss. Okay, what is it that you want to experience zero loss in? Do you want, you know, zero loss here or zero loss there? I say, no, I want no loss anywhere. And the ego says, wow, what part of anywhere? And just cannot understand what we're talking about. It thinks we're a little crazy. The ego says, wow, he's not able to express themselves clearly enough, because he's not able to pinpoint what area of loss do you want to work on. And they keep saying, no loss. We want no loss anywhere. We don't want to experience loss. Ego just shrugs his shoulders and says, you need to be more specific. I say, I am being specific. I specifically am saying I don't want any loss. And the ego says, but that's not a specific, that doesn't help me at all. Because I cannot know where to start with loss, getting rid of loss, if you don't specifically point out an area, like, say, let's start with getting rid of this loss here. And I said, no, I want to drop it all at once. And I want to, because if when I get rid of one loss here, it only causes unintended consequences and other loss in other areas. And I want to drop the whole scenario of loss. The ego doesn't understand that. Cannot understand that. The so-called intelligence of the universe cannot understand abstraction, totality, the kind of talk we're talking about, the zero talk, cannot understand it. Cannot be educated to understand it at all. It's always going to think that you're crazy. And it will say, well, what a pity. You know, if you finally drop loss, the ego will say, what a pity. What a pity. So when someone went completely insane. They're lost. They're lost to loss. They don't see, the ego doesn't see that. The ego believes that existence is home for us. That this lost scenario is our home. That this movie we're watching is our home. And so it thinks it's doing the best job it can by helping us adapt to our home. And here we have somebody who just completely drops out of it. The ego says, well, that one, gone forever. I mean, annihilated. They have no home anymore. Because the ego's unaware of reality. The intelligence of this dream of loss is unaware of reality. It's the managerial aspect of existence is unaware of reality. There is a way to manage loss. It's all being managed to deal with, you know, all the different demands, to deal with our reluctance. We don't really want it, to deal with that reluctance, to keep us interested in it, to keep the loss so it's not too severe here, too severe there, or sometimes real severe, depending on where we're at with trying to get used to the loss. It's all being managed. We call that the intelligence of the universe. It's just managing loss. It's just what we're doing. We have to manage it because it's a tricky situation, because we really want to just drop it. So we have to keep, it's like we're juggling, you know, all this juggling, all these things, because we want to drop it, and the ego, we desperately have to try and say, well, okay, we can drop it, but what part do you want dropped? Or where do we start the dropping? You know, and so you have to constantly struggle with all these defenses and things. That's the, we call it the intelligence of the universe. It's just the managing loss, this whole loss scenario, producing it. The producers have to keep throwing stuff into the movie, you know. It's like we're making a movie, and we have to keep weaving in these, all this stuff, like a soap opera, bringing in all these new things and keeping our interest and attention on it, because we really like, unhappy, very unhappy with it. And the ego is very solicitous, saying, just tell me what type of loss bothers you the most. If we say, look, I don't want any loss, the ego say, okay, like a good therapist, right? The ego is like a very good psychotherapist. And you go into the psychotherapist and say, doctor, I feel terrible. I hate loss. I don't want to have any more loss anymore. Can't stand it. I'm through with it. The doctor will say, yeah, okay, great. So tell me, what loss bothers you the most? Can you just tell me that? And you say, I hate all of it. And the doctor says, yeah, okay, I understand. But there must be some loss that you hate more than the others. You know, loss of your parents, loss of a love, loss of your money, loss of your health. Just tell me, open up and tell me, what loss do you really hate the most, what really bothers you the most, and then you start thinking, okay, well, you know, if I had this made, you know, a little better, I might feel better. And the doctor says, aha, now we're getting somewhere. Okay, so now we can start working on this loss, right? Let's say you fear the loss of relationship. Let's start working on your relationship. Okay, a loss of money. Well, let's start working on your job and your career. Let's make things a little better for you here, so you're not bothered so badly. That's the ego. Okay, that is the ego. The ego says, what can the ego do so that you're not bothered so badly by loss? Whereas the spiritual assurer says, don't draw any distinctions between loss. That's a delusion. It's all equally futile. It's all equally futile. And you're wasting your time by trying to cure, you know, trying to lessen loss in one area. You're wasting your time. It's a very dangerous thing to do. Drop the scenario of loss altogether. Set it down in exchange for the scenario of non-loss. That's the difference between the therapists and the reassurers of unconditional love. It's a difference, big difference. So what we're saying is that you cannot educate the ego. You cannot help the ego. The ego says, wants us to help the ego help us. The ego says, I'm just here to help you, so help me help you. You've heard that, help me help you. Cannot be done. Because the loss continues, severe. No matter what benefit, entitlement we think we have here, the overall scenario of loss continues severely. And remember, we don't want any loss. We're tired of loss in any form. I hated loss from the get-go. I was devastated by, if I see a dead little dead insect or something, I was devastated by it. I hated death in any form, a leaf off a tree, a flower wilting, completely devastated me. Really, I was just stunned and shocked, horrified by it. If the slightest sickness or injury just causes me to just freak out, can't stand it. I said, what is this? You know, this is crazy. There's no loss in reality. What is this place? What's happened to reality? What's happening? And of course, nothing's happened in reality. So we don't need to do anything about this loss scenario. Let it be. For those who want loss, let it be. Let them deal with it. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. That's what he's saying. Let those who want to continue on with the attempt to be prime creator, let them continue on. And if they want to educate the ego in some way, let them do that. Let them talk to the ego. Say, well, ego, if you just make this a little better, help me make this better, then okay, let them do it, because they're going to do it anyway. And if you engage in trying the ego thinks you're insane. It really does. That is the truth. The ego, if you come to the ego and say, I don't want any loss, and you're adamant about it, the ego thinks you're insane and says, I can't do anything for you. You're completely insane. Maybe you should take some meds. So you cannot change the ego's belief about reality. Anyone who believes in reality, the ego thinks they're insane. That is a fact. And you can't educate the ego, because the ego, it cannot change its point of view. It thinks it's here to help you. The managerial of this loss-based scenario believes it's here to help you adjust loss, really. That's true. So if you say, well, this bothers me, we'll say, okay, let's help some area that you're feeling really bothered so you can continue on with this. Give yourself a chance to adjust to it. So the ego believes its whole purpose is to get us to adjust to loss, get us to continue on with loss in the belief that eventually loss will pay off with a rebirth, a recreation. Okay, so it has zero interest or capability to free us from loss. There's none. It cannot be educated. You cannot. So interacting with the ego is futile. Cannot educate it. So everybody that comes to satsang, you know, they got this ego, won't let them go, and they say this ego thinks I'm insane, and it's terrible. I don't want them to think I'm insane, and I just want to help the ego see my point of view. And maybe I can help the ego help others, you know, make their loss a little less severe, etc. What can I do to help the world? Can't do anything. To those who want to stay with this loss scenario, their guide is the ego. And so we think if we educate the ego, we're going to help everyone, because then everyone will have less problem with the ego. It doesn't work that way. Okay, so now we're getting to it. We want to help the world. We want to help other people. We see that they're being deceived by the ego and misled, but they're loyal to the ego. So what we think the way to do it is we need to educate the ego, clarify for the ego. So then the ego say, oh, I understand the absolute now. I just didn't see it before. And then when all the rest of the people turn to the ego will say, hey, you know what? Some teacher really clarified for me, and now I see it. And let me give you the right advice now. Okay? That'll never happen. Can never happen. But that's what we're trying to do. And now we're getting somewhere. Really getting somewhere. You can't educate the ego. You can't save the world that way. You cannot. And we all get trapped into that through our compassion. Our compassion says, let me do the most I can do. And it seems like the ego's so interested in us, we say, hey, here's the ego, here's the problem, and yet it's talking to me, it's interested. You got to understand, the ego thinks you're insane. And it's only interested in trying to heal your insanity from its standpoint. So its interest in dialogue with you is not to change itself. It will pretend only to make you feel comfortable. The same way a therapist will play along with an insane person. Someone comes to them, they're a little bit off their rocker. The therapist will just play along and agree to get some trust there. To have some dialogue and trust, and then gradually the therapist will try to start moving them towards sanity. So the ego seems to want to engage us and listen to us, etc. But it's just trying to look to see where our insanity is coming from and what it can do to heal us of our insanity. That's it. It's not engaging us for the purpose of being educated. And it knows that we believe that. So it plays along and pretends to be educated. Pretends it's listening. Yeah. Yeah, okay, so consciousness and awareness and the wave is one with the ocean. And then the ocean is not separate from the wave, is not separate. And we don't have this experience and we're not touched by that. Okay, yeah, I get it. All right. That's the ego just playing along. Playing along, looking to see, how can I help this lunatic here? The ego's thinking that. How can I help this lunatic specify what's really bothering them? That's it. I mean, that's what's happening. When you're really hearing what the teacher's saying, it affects you in a deeper way. It's like this kind of a shock, dull shock, and permeates you. Permeate it everywhere. It's not localized anywhere. It's just this feeling of total permeation of some profound, seamless permeation. It's not education, it's permeation. And then, you know, the ego's on the sidelines, and then you look over and say, oh my gosh, I'm leaving that poor ego over there. I better go say hello and say, ego, I really learned something great. Let me share it with you. And the ego's all interested and saying, oh, good. He's engaging. She's engaging with me again. He, she. And great. Okay. Now what happened? Tell me what happened. And they say, yeah, I had this permeated by this insight that we need to choose a new idea, and they'll feel a loss-free experience. And that's really salvation. I really can get free of loss. And the ego say, oh, that's great. How are you going to share that with others? That's what the ego will say. How are you going to share that with others? That's great. And you start thinking, I don't know. And the ego says, maybe we can work on some way to, you know, share it with others. And why don't you give me some ideas about that? And you think, wow, the ego's interested. Maybe I can enlist its help. Maybe it's been transformed. See, if I get the ego transformed, then everybody will be saved. And you think, wow, I can be the savior of the world. And before you know it, you've lost your clarity. The ego's doing its number, its therapeutic number on you. Tapping in your compassion, saying, you got a great insight? Great, let's share it. Here we go. Help me understand what you saw, and I'll spread the word to everybody. And then it starts asking questions. Before you know it, your mind is just all spinning and you're all confused. And there you go. There you have a explanation of what goes on in satsang, what goes on in the world. And it's not like we're not making progress. It's just that we then say, well, how do I share this progress? And then whoever we meet, there's the ego. And the ego jumps up and says, hey, so-and-so, you know, I love your clarity. It's great. How can you better share that? How can I share it? How can we share it? And let's do it. That's the ego. And then the whole thing gets off the tracks. See, the ego, again, thinks that those teachers are completely insane. And pities him. You know, pity that fool. The ego looks at the great goose with pity, saying, wow, those poor lost souls, they went off the tracks and they're lost forever. Can't do anything for them. What a shame. Too bad, because they could have really helped. They could have really helped from the ego standpoint. As my teacher, Anandamayi, many went to her egoically and said, look, we know you're great. You can really help the world. You can save the world. You just help us out. She said, no, sorry. That's just, I don't feel any pull in that direction. Of course, you know, then they said, shh. Okay, too bad. What a shame. She just didn't have it. It's all a mirage, I guess. That's what the ego will conclude, that, you know, what a shame, what a pity that you're just unable to share it with the world. Meaning, with the ego. In other words, enlighten the ego. The ego just says, enlighten me. Enlightenment is for the ego. You know, that's the problem. We get hung up on enlightenment. And because we're trying to figure out, how do we enlighten the ego? If we enlighten the ego, everyone's going to be saved. We just have to find a way. The answer is there is no way, which seems paradoxical, because then you're feeling like, oh my gosh, this is all useless then, useless. And then you find out who's really on the path and who isn't. But we all are, but we find out who is willing to dig in and stick with it. Who's got the determination? Who really wants it? Because when you say there is no way to enlighten the ego, it feels like, for some, it feels like there's no hope then. No hope to save the world. We can't save the world. We can be saved from the world. In other words, we can't change the scenario of loss. The scenario of loss has to experience loss, severe loss, in some form. When we work with existence, all we're doing is shuffling the form of loss. We're exchanging one form of loss for another and thinking that we've made progress. That's it. That's all we're doing. 100% that's all we're doing. Nothing more than that. We're changing the frame around the picture here. Same picture. Loss. And we think, wow, look at that frame. Wow, we put a really neat frame up there. We've really made tremendous progress. I mean, I look at that frame and it's like, gosh, I love that frame. It's so much better than the other one. Meanwhile, the picture of loss is still staring, you know, staring at you. We try to distract ourselves from it. It still happens. So the answer is you cannot change the loss-based scenario to anything other than loss. Cannot. And if you could, it would be a terrible thing, wouldn't it be? It's a good thing we cannot. Because imagine all these people who want to be prime creator, all these souls, aspects of spirit. What if there was a way to completely change the scenario of loss into one of no loss at all, loss-freeness? They would feel like they were annihilated. They would feel zero capability to accomplish their goal. And since they believe that reality is already annihilated, they've forgotten it. So it's as far as they're concerned, there is no such thing. This is reality. And the only way to reach their goal is for this loss to be utilized. And if it's gone, they would feel annihilated. It would be, you know, the most terrible crushing of their hopes imaginable. It just caused, they'd go into like a complete shell-shocked. It would be the most vicious thing possible for them. So in no way should you try to free the loss scenario from loss. In no way should you try to do that. Except for those who truly want to get free of all loss. There might be some times when you might help them get through some sort of loss a little quicker and just say brush it off or whatever. But really, you should not be manipulating karma. You should not be trying to do anything, for the most part, about loss at all. You should not try to make the world a better place. That is a fool's errand. You should be exchanging the loss-based scenario for a loss-free scenario. That's what the spiritual path is all about. That's all that it's about. You can't educate the ego. The ego will always be in charge of loss. And loss will always be loss. The attempt to be prime creator will always give rise to this loss-based scenario. And the management of that, the ego, so to speak, will always be managing it the way that it manages it now. Never change. Will never change. It's constantly changing the frame, making it think like you can change it, but it's only doing that like a chameleon to try and figure out what it can do for you to keep you interested in loss. Like I said, the therapist agreeing with the insanity of the patient to try and establish a rapport, and then from that point try to figure out what specifically is bothering them, you know. That's the ego. The ego only pretending to be able to change, only pretending to be interested in what we're talking about is not. It thinks we're insane. It thinks truth is insane. Because the ego was the managerial aspect of existence, of loss. Of course, that only arose within the context of loss. Within the context of this idea of trying to be prime creator, it only arose from that. To manage it. If there wasn't any loss there, there would be no management of it. So the origins of the ego is this loss-based scenario, all these effects. That's where the origin isn't. It doesn't come from anywhere else. So it has no context at all other than this, and can never have it, because loss has to be managed. So we are the ones sustaining this scenario, not the ego. But to sustain it, it needs to be managed very cleverly. And so there is this clever management of this scenario going on. And it has to be very clever. It always will be. Cannot do anything about it. Cannot do anything about it. And those who want to stay within this last scenario, they will interact with the ego and go through all these changes, and they will think they're making progress. They will think they're being helped. And it'll just continue on the way it's always been. Let the dead bury the dead. Let the dead, those who are believing in loss, let them experience, you know, loss. Let them, they're going to experience it anyway. You can't stop them from it. So, and of course, you know, historically you'll be seen as a fool. Definitely. And maybe the ego will be gracious enough to say, well, I don't want that one to be seen as a fool. That's so sad. So I'm going to make up a bunch of stuff about it, make up stories and twist the teachings around and make it more ego-friendly. So people don't completely pay no attention, you know, and that's been done to teachers. So you really cannot establish a legacy in loss. Other than the flow from a loss-free presence here through those who also choose loss-free presence, there is that transmission, that flow of freedom. Various traditions, various lineages. That's why there's lineages from great teachers, great gurus. That certain great teachers have helped others set down the whole scenario of loss in exchange for unconditional love, and then they're able to advise others the right way, and that continues on through the flow of history. But it can never be mainstreamed. Cannot be mainstreamed. And that, of course, that is the carrot that the ego holds out to us. You know, maybe if we go on Oprah, we're able to share with the whole world, and we can mainstream this, and we're all going to get it. Eventually, all will get it. But for those who still want loss, can't mainstream it for them. Cannot truly mainstream it. Maybe you can reach out to others, but you can't mainstream it. Cannot mainstream in existence means the lost scenario. You cannot mainstream it. If you do, you have to distort it and twist it into something that appeals to them. Like, let's save the world. Let's bring peace to the world. Let's build heaven on earth. All this stuff is just an attempt to mainstream it. Make it palatable to the ego. So people can listen to the ego and say, oh, I got a teacher right here. The ego's telling me the truth. Yeah, the ego's saying that there's a way to save the world. This teacher here, this great teacher's enlightened. And they said, hey, there's a way to save the world, and we can do it. Let's all get together and network and social network and be activist, and we can change the world. They're listening to the ego. And the ego's claiming to be enlightened now because some teacher is teaching the same thing. The ego says, look, I'm just teaching what this enlightened teacher is teaching. But no enlightened teacher teaches that. But sometimes in an attempt to go mainstream, they might say that. I've seen that happen. I see it happening right now. There may be some teachers in this world right now who might be awake to truth, and they're trying to reach out to others and move this out in the world, and they're finding it's very difficult, and very few will want to listen, and they may at some point think, how can I mainstream this? You know, it's a common thing to do this. How can I mainstream it? How can I reach more? And then, you know, the ego says, well, you know, I'll tell you what, the people really want to do is they want to save this world, you know. So if you tell them you can help them bring peace to this world, my gosh, you got it. But really, you have to draw the line somewhere. And you really cannot teach that, because when you do that, you're off the tracks already. You cannot bring peace to this world. You cannot bring peace to a loss-based scenario. How could you? Where there's loss, there's no peace. To say that we can bring peace to this world is a misdefining of peace entirely. We're only peaceful when there's no loss, because there's no loss in reality. When there's any loss at all, it's troublesome for us. Like I said, I was greatly disturbed by even the tiniest evidence of loss, and I still am. I've just tried to not react to it anymore. You know, which is why I try to, you know, if I see the flowers and they're not perfect, I just get so upset. If I see any plant and there's any evidence of sick, you know, brown leaf or sickness or anything, can't stand it. Terrible. See, you know, just any decay, any loss, any breaking down, sickness, loss in any form at all, any form, it just like nails on a chalkboard to me. Just freaks me out. Can't stand it. So how can there be peace when there's loss? You're not peaceful when there's loss. Because when there's loss, you think, my gosh, reality, all of reality could be lost. How am I going to protect it? There's no peace there. It disturbs your peace entirely if you're honest about it. And so we bring peace to this world. What do you mean? Does that mean that you're not going to have a single insect ever die? You're not going to have anything ever die? Anything ever wilt? Not, you're going to have perfect conditions at all times? Zero scarcity? No sickness? No dying? Really? In existence? Because that's what you'd have to do in order to bring peace to the world. Any peace at all. Peace is total. You either have peace or you don't. You either have unconditional love or you don't. You either have loss or you don't. You can't have both. Okay, this is the central teaching of the very best teachers that unfortunately I was able to come in contact with them because I wanted to. I really wanted help. You can't have both truth and lies be true. You can't have both loss and no loss at the same time. It's impossible. If you have any loss at all, you're having loss. It's not the same as no loss. It is not the same. How can you say, anyone say, that some loss, a little bit of loss, is the same as no loss? And that's the so-called peace of mind you have with a little bit of loss is the same as the peace of mind with no loss. How can anyone believe that? And that needs to be looked at. Because, again, we're in the relative mind, the relativity of, like, a little bit is not as bad as a lot. A little bit of loss is not as bad as a lot of loss. It's not true. Because any loss establishes the principle of loss, would establish the principle of loss that is possible. Which means the idea of no loss is invalid. Right? It would invalidate. Even the tiniest loss would invalidate the idea that there's no such loss as impossible. It would invalidate it. Even the tiniest bit. So, the ego, of course, cannot see this. Cannot see it. All the real teachings that are important, the ego cannot understand, cannot see. And so then we hear this, and we go back to the ego and discuss it with the ego, and before you know it, we've lost it. Happens to everyone. Happens to me. Happens to you. Happens to everyone except those who are perfectly assured in unconditional love with no desire, you know, for anything other than that. It doesn't happen to them, which is why when you go to see them, they're exactly the same as before. They never change. They're always totally on point, but totally clear. There's no oscillation. It's effortless form, effortless. Those are rare. Those are rare here. So in the meantime, we do the best we can. Hoping that those rare birds will show up. But if they do, meanwhile, we don't wait. We do the best we can, which is to point out this dynamic, which is what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to do the best I can, short of being in unconditional love without exception. Short of that, you simply do have to work on clarification, realizing that it's not an end in itself. But it brings us closer to making the right decision. Seeing that we can't save the world, we can't change the world, we can't help the ego. We can't help others through the ego. It's not possible. The ego's insane. The ego has no right context, has no context of reality, no vision or understanding of reality whatsoever. Zero. None. Can never be educated to have one. It has no basis. It arose as the managerial aspect of loss. That's all that it is. When we exchange loss for non-loss, we don't need a manager of loss anymore. That's it. It's over. No need for it. And so maybe we're trying to find a role for the ego in the loss-free situation. There is no role. There is no role for managing. Unconditional love doesn't need a manager. There's nothing to manage. It's equally present everywhere, all times, all places, all situations. It's not changing at all, not being modified at all. What is there to manage? There's no management needed. So we're so accustomed to dealing with this manager of existence. of this loss, that when we try to experience unconditional love, or if we do for a moment, we will look around for the manager and we say, okay, I need to consult with the manager and share this to help manage things. So I think what we're getting to here is we need to see the experience of unconditional love. There is no need for managing it at all. There is no manager. We're free of needing to consult the manager. And if we can somehow come back to this point, this point, you know, I don't know if it's possible or not, but most likely there is no manager to consult. Don't need to consult a manager. We don't need to figure out how to share this with others by consulting the manager. Share it better, etc. There's no dynamic like that arises. And of course, we might assume like, whoa, wait a minute. If I'm not consulting with how to share this with the manager, how to share it better, I won't be able to share it with anyone. There you go. See, therein lies the problem. It's our own compassion that causes us to disconnect with unconditional love. We get tricked. How many of us have been tricked many times? We say, oh, I'm right there, and then we trick ourselves and say, oh, I lost it. Where'd it go? It's compassion. Compassion tricks us because compassion has to be perfectly clear itself. Otherwise, we're going to lose the goose that laid the golden egg. You know, this unconditional love. We're gonna not be aware of it. Because we're going to say, I need to manage this, and there isn't any managerial opportunity. So, what the teacher, like Ananda Maima, is feeling is effortless. There's no management. She's not managing what she's feeling at all. And she's okay with that. So, this feeling continues unabated, totally smooth. She was in perfect bliss all the time, not managing it. She knew she didn't have to manage it. There's nothing to manage. You can't increase it by trying to manage it. You see that? So it was wise compassion there. And then she simply, the teacher simply abides in this management-free condition that cannot be increased or decreased or made better or worse or anything. Just trust that can be felt by others. And it's as good as it gets. It's already as good as it gets. There's nothing that can be done more or less. There's no management issues involved. And realize all the questions that are asked cannot pertain to how to manage this unconditional love. There's nothing the teacher needs to do better as far as managing the love. It's already perfect. It's already perfect. So if the teacher can avoid that trap, then you have a real teacher on your hands. Real teacher. That's the whole trick, you know, and how well a teacher does that is the true measure of a teacher here, is if they can completely trust in unconditional love, that they don't have to do anything about it. They cannot do anything about it. There's no nothing to change. As soon as they try to change unconditional love, they've lost it. They're unaware of it. They're back in the ego. Because the whole purpose of experiencing unconditional love is you cannot change it. You cannot modify it. So that reminds us of reality. So there is this pull between those who come to see the teacher and the teacher. Those who come to see the teacher, they're full of compassion. They say, I've got to find some way to help, you know, spread the love. And what you have to say is, the love is already spread everywhere. It's done. Done deal. It's done from the beginning. There's no more spreading. There's no more spreading needed. There was never any spreading. It was all simultaneously overlaid. From the very beginning, unconditional love was boundless. There's no spreading. It was the intensity It already is what it is. There's no change in intensity. It's already perfect. There's nothing that needs to be done except to realize that nothing needs to be done. And that is true compassion. But of course, those who come will struggle with this. Because they want to go back to their communities and they want to help out. And say, how can I help out my community? You know, if I can't spread love and I need to, can you go there and hug people? And can, you know, what? Well, maybe. But there is this extremely tricky dynamic with false compassion, of compassion that's grounded in the ego. See, the ego thinks it has compassion too. The ego believes it's totally compassionate. Really. The ego believes that it is perfectly compassionate. And it sees the compassion of unconditional love is actually very selfish. Very selfish. Because it's not sharing it with others. It's not bringing peace to the world. It just is. The ego thinks, my gosh, that's nothing but selfishness, you know, from the ego standpoint. But the ego is insane. It's the ego that's completely insane. It doesn't have any idea of reality. So how could it say that you're selfish, meaning what you're doing is you're being reminded of yourself, which is what the only option you have, other than loss, which is nothing. You either have an option of nothing or everything. So how compassionate is it of the ego to insist on that you keep embracing nothing? Is that compassionate or is that insanity? It's insanity. The ego hides its insanity through compassion. All right, and the ego thinks without the ego there'd be no compassion whatsoever. No, without the ego, that means if there was no ego, it means that the whole scenario of loss is not arising in the first place, which means we've exchanged it for the idea of not trying to be prime creator, which means we are what we know what we are, we know what reality is, and we know one. So the idea of being selfish, what does that mean? Reality is one. So if you're remembering reality, you're remembering everything. So you're not being selfish, being the opposite of that. You're being one with all that is. So the ego is completely insane. Completely insane. And it's not easy to come into this world and be confronted with this total insanity. Because it feels like you're not getting anywhere. Ananda Maima said that, really, in her, all the time she was here, what, how many years? 86 years. There weren't many that came to her for truth. Not many. But she never tried to expand it, you know, change it. No. Just abided in unconditional love, and those who came, those who didn't. She knew that if you tried to engage the ego in helping, it would actually torpedo the whole thing and make the world a worse place, a much worse place. Then you have faults, you know, the ego would build a whole false dynamic around the teacher and say the teacher was really teaching this and twist everything, and everybody then would think that in listening to the ego, they're really listening to this teacher, and then they'd follow the ego even more. And so, you know, it just gets bad, gets worse. So I hope that by saying these things, I'm helping. I believe that I am, because, you know, it's putting everything in a stronger context, a clear context, which is vital, vitally important. We're not always trying to get to a point. We're often trying to clarify a context, the whole context in which teachers come into this world and what they struggle with and how they can get off the track. You know, that's important to see it. Very important as wisdom. Because as you see it, you yourself get closer to being a teacher, actually. Because you see, oh, these are the problems. And this is how to avoid these problems. I guess that's what a teacher, I mean, to be a teacher, you have to avoid the problems. You have to know how to truly teach truly. Otherwise, you're not even a teacher at all. You're just a fake. You're just an ego teacher. Teacher helping the ego out. Believing in the ego's compassion. And being completely, you know, deceived by that. So, there you go. That's enough for this morning. For right now, I could go on and on, but I don't want to give you a 2-hour, 45-minute video. That's too much. It's important stuff because it's all coming down now. And the loss is coming. We're in a destruct phase. Dance of destructivity is underway big time. And again, on a subtle level, it's been raging inferno for quite some time. In this world, it has not yet become a raging inferno, but there have been some hot spots, haven't there? Really have been some hot spots. And this whole thing with the Colorado thing, you know, that's like a indication of what's taking place, you know, just an intrusion into this dream, this world, an intrusion, a sudden intrusion, right, where we don't expect it. We're watching this movie and we think, well, yeah, the movie's violent, but you know, we're safe from it, because, and then into this violent movie intrudes, you know, actual violence kind of thing. That's kind of like a metaphor for what's going to happen here in the world. In the subtle level, there's extreme violence already. It hasn't intruded into this physical plane yet, but it most likely will. It most likely will. And this incident there is like that. It's like we think, oh, we're watching a movie, and it's like on a subtle plane. On the subtle plane, there's all this terrible violence and mayhem taking place, right? But we think, no, here on the physical plane, we're not suffering it. There's a separation between the subtle and the physical. And then suddenly into this experiencing of the subtle on the screen intrudes actual violence on the physical. And that just, you know, freaks everybody out, freaks us out. I mean, we're freaked out. Let's be honest. This is a freak out. You know, because the way that it happened, it just like portrayed what's going to happen in the future. The subtle levels that we cannot see, experiences through our senses, on that level is going to intrude on the physical level now. It's going to be a crossover, so to speak. And so we the so-called security we used to have shattered, you know. So it is vitally important to set the context of true teachers and true teaching and how we can actually do it, how can we actually be done. It is doable. We're all capable of doing it if we can avoid the pitfall. You know, if we can see the ego for what it is, set down the whole scenario of loss as one instead of trying to work on it. Just set the whole thing down. It's the only way. And then don't begin. It's not easy. It's doable. You know, the great teachers, we have examples that it's been done. It's been done here. That's why I know it can be done. My teacher, along with my other teachers, Jesus and Ramana Maharshi, they did it. They did it. Absolutely. So I know it can be done. We know it can be done. We don't even have to entertain the ego at all. At all. Zero. Now, will we be able to do that? Maybe. Maybe. Sometimes teachers get off the tracks and they get back on. You have to, right? I mean, sometimes they're sharing unconditional love and then they get tempted to try to share it through helping the ego, and then they get off track and then they get back on track. That's possible. That is possible. I'm seeing some of that. We'll see how it goes. I mean, it's not surprising if a teacher gets off track. It's not surprising. Not at all. People shouldn't freak out over that. Everyone should take a step back. Teacher, you know, let me take a step back. You know, I got a little foolish with my compassion. Give the teacher the opportunity to do that, you know? If the teacher says, you know, hey, I need to take a step back, please do, you know, please do. And then they can regain their clarity and choose unconditional love again and realize, you know, that they try not to share it with the ego again. Try not to get into a dialogue with the ego again. Try not to get believe that the ego has to be. Try not to manage unconditional love. Try not to get off track again. Go forward, and if they get off track again, then they got to step back again. So I really, teachers here in the world sometimes do have to take a step back, which is why it's dangerous for a teacher to come here and say that they're it. They're perfect. They're the perfect guru, the perfect teacher, because they're selling an image of perfection, and what they're selling is so tied into this that they can't take a step back. To take a step back would be to admit their imperfection, and what they're selling is that they're a flawless teacher. And so they don't take steps back. They keep doubling down, and it's you, the devotee, that is bad, not them. It never is them. Never. They say, I cannot never get off track. They keep doubling down, and before you know it, there's an abusive situation, and it all falls to pieces. So unconditional love is always perfect, but the witnessing to that in this world is rarely perfect. And we should not be surprised if it's not perfect in all cases. You know, there are some teachers who did it perfectly. A few, but not many. And so it shouldn't be a surprise. We should set ourselves up so that we have no way to fall back on, wait a minute, I need to get back on track. Say, wait a minute, I'm feeling a little shaky here with teaching. I need to take a step back. When you set up a perfect teacher with devotees, there's no fallback, right? Because the whole thing is being held together by the belief that this teacher can never fail, that they're somehow inherently perfect. Well, unconditional love is inherently imperfect, but the sharing of that in this world can easily go wrong. Almost always does. Almost always gets off track, because again, we try to blend it with the ego. We try to blend loss and no loss. That's our delusion. Everyone's deluded. So the pressure for the teacher to somehow give out some sort of snake oil is incredible pressure, and it's very par for the course that teachers will succumb to this at some point, and then they need to take a step back. They said, hey, I made a bogey on this hole, you know? I'm not, you know, a perfect golfer. I'm not a perfect teacher. So look out for the ones that say they're perfect teachers. The ones that are perfect teachers, I don't believe they ever say they are. Ananda, my mom, never said she was a perfect teacher. She even refused to say she was a teacher or a guru or anything. She said, I'm nothing. I'm just a simple little girl. That's all. You just wanted me to come here, so I came. But I'm your little daughter. I'm your sister. I'm your friend. But I'm nothing. And if she was severely pressed, a few times she would just say, well, I'm just that which is untouched by all the change that takes place. She said, even though in the halls of existence, this universal dance continues and takes place for all eternity, what I am remains exactly the same. I'm untouched by any of it. But these were not really declarations of herself as a teacher. No. No need, because the love was there. She knew the love is already there. Just let the love be there. Let this unconditional love be there. And then, you know, respond to inquiry. But she said everything's already perfect, meaning nothing that she needs to do. The unconditional love already overlays everything. It's already perfect. And just tell us everything is already perfect. Don't worry. Don't worry. She said, I'm always with you. In other words, the unconditional love is always with us. These teachers speak from the position of unconditional love. When they say, I am always with you, they don't mean the person, the body. They mean this unconditional love is always with you. And they say, this is the way. It's the only way. When Jesus says, I am the way, this is the only way, meaning this unconditional love is the only way. This loss-free experience is the only alternative to a loss-based scenario. There's no other alternative. Either we have a loss-based scenario or we have a loss-free scenario, right? There's that point again, right? It's either one or the other. It's either one or the other. Okay, so be kind to your teachers, whoever they may be, because they're under a lot of pressure. Almost unimagined pressure. And they can and do get off track. And if they realize it, you know, give them space. If they realize it, they need to say, wait a minute, I need to go on a retreat for a little while. and kind of recharge my clarity here and get back on track. Let him do it. Don't criticize him for it at all. No, because that's wise. That's wisdom. You don't want the teacher just keeps doubling down. And I mean, if there is a flawless teacher, then that's great. So they don't need to take a retreat. And even they might need to refresh themselves a little bit from the barrage. But they're not off track. But most, you know, at some point, we'll get a little bit off, get off track. It's, you know, they made a bogey. Or maybe they made a par. They're not going to birdie every hole. Maybe they make a par, you know, say, okay. You don't say, oh, you know, you're no good. You're not a perfect teacher, et cetera, et cetera. No, unconditional love is always there for us. It's always perfect. So, you know, it's just those who tell us about it are not necessarily going to always stay on point. They're going to waver with compassion maybe a little bit. Doesn't mean that unconditional love isn't there for us. It is. It's like someone goes to a faraway land, comes back and tells us about it, and under the pressure of all this barrage of questioning, they maybe start changing their story or forgetting, et cetera. And then people say, ah, you changed your story. I don't even believe it's there, where what you're talking about, that faraway land, that perfect land. I don't even believe it's there at all. No, it can't be, because you changed your story. No, that's ridiculous, okay? That is, of course, totally ridiculous. And since we have the perfect teachers, we know it's true already. We know it's true. So we know what the teachers are pointing to is there. Because we had Ramana and Anandamayima and Jesus and others, Buddha. We had other teachers that for sure we know is there. So we cannot just jump into this, you know, teacher, you fell off the tracks. I can't believe anything you say. I'm going to just toss the whole thing. That is just nonsense. That is nonsense. So with this context in mind, we move forward into, again, this cycle of destructivity, of loss, with the very likely impingement in the physical plane of the subtler planes, the etheric plane. The subtler planes could very well begin to impinge, which is why I started this video out with ET. Because the advertisements for the London Olympics, some of them are so bizarre, are so weird, and from those who are wise enough, it's obvious what they're depicting. They're depicting the subtle realms, subtle etheric realms, infrared realms, subtler realms, impinging, coming into this physical realm. That's what they're showing. And so, you know, somebody, a lot of people, at some level, have been working on this impingement, and they've set it all up to happen. And maybe it's going to happen during the Olympics. Possible. Anyway, keep listening to the best teachers you can find. That's the answer. Keep your inquiry. Unconditional love is present for you equally as it is for any teacher who's ever been on this planet. It's perfect. It's flawless. It's omnipresent, it's boundless, it's non-modifiable, there's no loss, there's no need to manage it, and it's equally available to all. All have equal access to it every single moment, always will. We're all pre-qualified to experience it, so everything is okay. Everything is perfect. All we have to do is choose that perfection. Very great. That's it for this video.